morning, church. Welcome to service online. I'm excited today to preach on the second part of our preaching series, God and Work, the worker who pleases God. Last week, Pastor Sabrina preached on three main reasons why we should work and three principles that brings the blessing of God. The principles are working with passion, working with purpose, and working with power. If you haven't heard it, I want to encourage you to log in to our website at www.reason.sg to have a listen. I'm sure you will be blessed. Today, we are going to look at the life of Joseph, the attitude that he had that brought him success in work. Let's pray. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for this time. Thank you, Lord, that we are able to gather in such a manner. Today, I pray that you bless the reading of the word. I pray that you open the eyes and the ears of your people so that they can hear you clearly this morning. In Jesus' name, we pray. Amen. Amen. Let me start by giving you a summary of Joseph's career path. You can find the story of Joseph in Genesis chapter 37 to 50. You know, Joseph had the most demanding job. First, he was a slave, and then he was a prison supervisor, and finally, the prime minister of Egypt. He had the most demanding boss, a very cunning lady boss, Mrs. Potiphar, who seduced him and even accused him of seducing her and sent him to prison. He had the worst working environment in an Egyptian prison, locked in a dark and dingy cell. You know, he had no job prospect at all when he was forgotten for years in the prison. And when a ray of hope came where he could be set free, he was forgotten by the cupbearer who was supposed to speak well of him to the Pharaoh. But you know, through it all, Joseph was not discouraged. Every time he faced adversity, he would use it to develop himself and make a comeback one after another. He thrived throughout his career. You know, his attitude pleases God, and God makes him successful in his career. So this morning, the question is, do you want to be successful in your career? You know, to be successful in our career, we need to have working attitude that pleases God. We can learn four attitudes from Joseph that brought him success in his work. The first attitude of a worker who pleases God is to invite the presence of God to your work. In the story of Joseph, it was mentioned many times that God was with him at work. In fact, it was mentioned four times in chapter 39 alone. You know, the presence of the Lord was with him throughout his work. From his job as a slave in Potiphar's house to the prison when he was a prison supervisor, and eventually when he became the prime minister of Egypt. Because the Lord was with him, Joseph experienced blessings and great success in his work. So what happened when you have God's presence with you? You know, when God's presence is with you, you will experience prosperity. In Genesis chapter 30, verse 2 to 6, the Lord was with Joseph so that he prospered and he lived in the house of his Egyptian master. God made Joseph prosperous. He lived in the master's house and take care of the household. Instead of laboring out in the field under the hot sun and rain. You know, when God is with you, you will experience his abundant provision of wisdom, of peace, and of strength to do the work. you will not be duly stressed and you will enjoy your work every day. You will shine in your job and you will be rewarded. You know, when God's presence is with you at work, you will experience favor and success. Verse 3, when his master saw that the Lord was with him and that the Lord gave him success in everything he did, Joseph found favor in his eyes and became his attendant. Potiphar put him in charge of his household, and he entrusted to his care everything he owned. You know, the Lord was with Joseph and he gave him success. He found favor in Potiphar's eyes. You know, Potiphar saw the blessing in Joseph's life and it convinced him to put Joseph in charge of his whole household. Now, God promoted Joseph to be second in charge of the master's house. You know, when God's presence is with you, you will experience success in your work. No matter how difficult a task is, you are able to do it and make it work. You will have favor from your colleague, from your superior, from your customer, and that will make your work easy. You know, God will go before you and set the path for you. You need not have to strive, but you will thrive. Amen? Amen. And thirdly, when God's presence is with you, you will be a blessing to others. Verse 5. From the time he put him in charge of his household and all that he owned, the Lord blessed the household of the Egyptians because of Joseph. The blessing of the Lord was on everything Potiphar had, both the house and the field. Because of God's blessing in Joseph's life, the house and the field of Potiphar were also blessed. Everything under Joseph's care and authority multiplied and prospered. You know, the presence of God not only brings blessing to you, it also brings blessings to your company. Through the work of your hand, your colleague will be blessed. Your company will be blessed. You will be treasured by your boss, and your company will want to retain you. And you know what? Promotion will come to you. So do you invite the presence of God every day to you, every day before you go to work? Do you invite him into your work project? Do you pray about the sales negotiation that you are about to embark on? Do you pray for your boss, for your colleague, and for your customer? Do you ask God for his favor and wisdom to do your work? You know, friends, to have the God's presence near means to be close to God. There is only one way to be close to God. That is to spend time in prayer, in worship, and in reading of his word. You know, let his word strengthen you and give you strength every day. Today, would you commit to spending time with God? Remember, our success at work is dependent upon God and not on our own capability. Now we move on to the second part of Joseph's story in chapter 39. You know, the second attitude of a worker that pleases God is integrity. To have integrity means to be honest and have strong moral value. Having integrity is very important in our relationship in the workplace. You know, we spend an average of 42 to 44 hours a week at work, and this is MOM standard. Our behavior is observed by our colleague, and they will associate that with how they view God and Christianity. chapter 7, Matthew 7 verse 16 tell us that we are known by our fruit. So let us go forth and display good fruit, living out integrity in our workplace. So the next question we'd ask ourselves is, how does integrity look like in the workplace? Integrity is expressed in two ways in Joseph's life. Integrity means do not commit sexual sin. Genesis chapter 39 verse 9b. My master has withheld nothing from me except you, because you are his wife. How then could I do such a wicked thing and sin against God? Now Joseph was well built and handsome, and soon his master's wife took notice of him and asked him to go to bed with her, not once, but day after day. It was not a one-time temptation. It was a daily temptation. No, but Joseph did not commit adultery with his master's wife. He knew it was a wicked sin to do, and he made up his mind not to sin against God. You know, office romance is one of the most common temptations faced by workers today. You know, a little flirting here, a little dirty talk there. It is a deadly trap set up by the enemy to cause your downfall. So do not open the doors to adultery and to fornication. It is a slippery slope to go down on. You keep alert and clear-minded. Decide in your mind to be pure and holy before God. If you sense this temptation in your workplace, flee like Joseph. You know, run away from the temptation. You know, often we are not strong enough to overcome it on our own, but we need to run away quickly to escape the temptation, then account to someone. Integrity also means do not lie. Proverbs chapter 12 verse 22. The Lord detests lying lips, but he delights in people who are trustworthy. Joseph was truthful to Potiphar's wife. He told her plainly that he cannot accede to his request of sleeping with her. He didn't beat around the bush, but he was not afraid to offend her. He told her honestly that he cannot do such a wicked thing and sin against God. Was there a time where you lie or hide a truth because you are afraid to offend someone, or you wanted to protect yourself or your colleague from being found out? We cannot hide the truth of make-up story to cover up our mistake. The Bible calls it lying. We should always be honest. Tell the truth. Own up to our mistake, even though it means facing serious consequences in our career. From chapter 40 onwards, we see Joseph's career path taking off after his release from prison. The third attitude that pleases God is humility. Genesis chapter 41 verse 15 to 16. Pharaoh said to Joseph, I had a dream and no one can interpret it. But I have heard it say of you that when you hear a dream, you can interpret it. I cannot do it, Joseph replied to Pharaoh, but God will give Pharaoh the answer he desires. You know, Joseph started off his career as a young, arrogant boy. At the age of 17, he had no hesitation to tell his parents and his brother about the dreams he had, about them bowing down before him. From the day he started work in Potiphar's house, to the time where he was made in charge of the prison, the Lord was with him, showing him kindness and blessing him. But throughout the entire period, he has never once attributed his success to God. In fact, he thinks that he is the greatest in Potiphar's house. He kept all the credits to himself. God had to humble him by sending him to prison. Joseph had to go through the test of humility for 13 years. You know, the breakthrough came when he testified to Pharaoh that it was God who provided the interpretation of his dream and not him. Because he humbled himself, God felt he was ready for his true identity. And that was to be the second in charge of Egypt and to save his family during the famine. You know, friends, to experience success in your work, you must work with humility. In the corporate world, to be humble means to acknowledge your limitation and be teachable. You may say you know a lot, but no one can say you know it all. We must appreciate others and give them the due credit. Do not let your ego stand in the way. Seeking feedback is also an humbling act. Always maintain an open mind. Be ready to unlearn and relearn. You know, the acts of humility are difficult, but you can make great impact in your workplace. When people see that you are humble, you will gain favor and respect and trust from your colleague and from your superior. And for those who are leading a team, your staff will be satisfied with you. They will work longer in the organization because they know you are humble and they can trust you and talk to you. Would you ask God today to give you humility? Yes. The fourth attitude of a worker that pleases God is steward your gifts. A worker who stewards the gift at work pleases God. Joseph had the gift of interpreting dreams. Genesis chapter 40, verse 8. We both had dreams, they answered, but there is no one to interpret it. Then Joseph said to them, "Do not interpretations belong to God? Tell me your dream." Joseph had the gift of interpreting dreams to God. When the cupbearer and the baker did not understand the meaning of their dreams, Joseph volunteered to interpret it for them. Not only that, Joseph also interpreted Pharaoh's dream accurately. Joseph knew the gift God has given him and he stewarded it boldly. Joseph also had the gift of administration. Genesis chapter 39, verse 6a. So Potiphar left everything he had in Joseph's care. With Joseph in charge, he did not concern himself with anything except the food he ate. Now, Joseph also has great administrating gift. He stewarded his administrating gift diligently when he was serving in Potiphar's house. He was so good at managing the household that Potiphar left everything under his care. He also stewarded his administrative gift when he was in prison. He was so excellent in organizing the prisoner that the warden made him the chief, in charge of all the inmates and their care. And the third gift that Joseph had was the gift of leadership. Genesis chapter 41, verse 39 to 40. Then Pharaoh said to Joseph, Since God has made all this known to you, there is no one so discerning and wise as you. You should be in charge of my palace, and all my people are to submit to your orders. Only with respect to the throne will I be greater than you. After Joseph's presentations to Pharaoh with the solution of solving the 7 years famine, Pharaoh immediately recognized Joseph's extraordinary leadership gift. Joseph had great leadership gifts. He successfully managed the food crisis. He relieved the poverty of the Egyptian and even brought a revenue from selling the grains to other nations. He was a great leader. He knew his gift and he had stewarded them confidently. What are the gifts that God has blessed you with? All of you are blessed with gifts and talent, and we should use it in our workplace. God did not give us gifts and talents to keep, but we are to use them so that we can reap the benefits from it. Discover your gifts by trial and error and find out what you are good at, and then work on it diligently and let it grow. Maybe it's administrative, maybe it's operations, or maybe it's even IT. Whatever it is, do not doubt what God has given to you. Steward your gift with confidence. When you use your gift to serve God in your work, He will be pleased and grant you success. You know, a few years ago, I made a career switch and to take on my dream job. After 2 years, things did not work out, so I had to resign and look for a new job. So very soon, I was offered a job in my former company. It was a junior position. The manager whom I reported to was my former subordinate. So in my prayer to God, I told God, if this job is for me, then you have to deal with my pride. The first few months into the job was tough. I had to humble myself and take instructions. It was very difficult. I heard sarcastic remark from my co-worker and it hurt badly. But God was good. He strengthened me, and very soon I was doing well in my work. So every morning I will read God's word and I will meditate of His word and let the word carry me throughout the day. I built good relationship with my colleagues. I was honest and sincere at all times, and I will exercise my gift as and when God allows me to do so. God taught me humility. Although I have the wealth of doing my work, I will always have an open posture to learn from others. I'm not afraid to admit my mistake in front of my colleague. You know, every day my strength comes from God. God bless me with wisdom to do my work. He grants me favor from my peers, from my staff, from my superiors. You know, He rewarded me with a promotion and a good payout. I'm happy in my current work, and I thank God for making me to be that worker who pleases Him. So in summary, the attitude of a worker that pleases God is to invite the presence of God to your work. And second, integrity and humility. And lastly, to steward your gifts. Let us pray. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord, for your word this morning. Lord, I pray even at their home, your people will respond to your word. They will be honest with you and allow you to do the transformation work in their life. In Jesus' name, I pray. Even where you are seated in your living room or in your study room, I encourage you to close your eyes and bow your head. The first group of people I want to speak to, you dread to go to work every day and you find it difficult to do your work. You want to experience the presence of God in your workplace. Today, you desire to be close to God and to ask Him to guide you in your work. You have decided to start reading His Word and spending time with Him every day. Would you pray and make this commitment this morning? Whisper to God this morning. Yes. And the second group of people, God is dealing with your heart concerning having integrity in your work. Perhaps you work in a toxic environment. There is sexual temptation and you need to flee from it. Perhaps the Lord is speaking to you about falling into the temptation of lying and you want to surrender this area to the Lord. Would you talk to God right now about it? Yes, talk to God right now. And the third group of people, you know you are proud at heart and you find it difficult to humble yourself. You do not acknowledge God for the gifts and talent He has given to you. Today you want to repent and ask God to deal with your pride. You desire to change and work with humility. Respond in prayer right now to ask God to change your heart, to let the transformation take place in your heart. Yes, amen. Amen. And the last group of you, perhaps you are not sure of the gifts that God has blessed you with. You want to know your gifts and you desire to be successful. For some of you, you have not been stewarding your gifts diligently. Today, you want to ask God to give you the opportunities to steward your gift. Respond in prayer and ask God to reveal to you your gifts. Ask God to open the door so that you can steward your gift and be a blessing to your company. Would you be honest to God today and tell God to do the work in your heart? Amen. Let me pray. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus, for how you have spoken to us this morning. As your people respond to you from their home, you know exactly what their prayer is. You know what their need is. And you know, oh God, that their desire is to be the worker who pleases you. And may you, God, help them in all areas of their lives. Thank you, Jesus. And would you now lift up your hand as I pray the benediction over you. And may the Lord our God, who loves us so much, and the grace of Jesus Christ, who is always more than sufficient, and the power of the Holy Spirit be with you forever and ever. So, church, go and be the worker who pleases God. We'll see you next week. Goodbye.